Xin mời chương ông quý chú. Ông chương nhập đẹp bậc cả, ông to, cái dòng nào càng để tệ bị thì xã mạng ca. Hay chưa kịch bằng to đi, xôm chun phía đẹp đi từ chợ cầm sông mắc này bàn tăng dùng nua đó lệ chùm niên cả vì phực minh môn về xóm rạ hà thay trọng hay bà hai chỉ lục chợ cầm nơi miền dùng nua trở xua đó lệ chùm niên tiết được chứ này cứ xôm chơi lục chợ cầm sông mắc.
Monsieur l'expert, ce matin, vous avez évoqué, pour employer un mot neutre, un certain nombre d'incidents qui se sont produits entre le Vietnam et le Cambodge en 1975, 1976 et également au début de l'année 77. Parmi ces incidents, vous avez fait état d'un incident concernant un navire, je crois qu'il s'appelait le Mayaguez. Vous avez également fait état d'incidents concernant des îles situées dans le golfe de Thaïlande. Est-ce que vous pourriez nous donner plus, si vous le pouvez, plus de précision concernant l'importance de ces incidents? Est-ce que vous avez, par exemple, une idée s'il y a eu des morts, s'il y a eu des blessés, si il a été fait usage d'un matériel militaire particulier, s'il y avait des troupes importantes? Qu'est-ce que vous pouvez nous dire à ce sujet?
As I said before, my memory of that period is rather vague at this point. But looking at the book, what I wrote at the time, I do recall that some of the attacks were conducted by the Khmer Rouge. Not necessarily, I don't think that they had navy as such, but they used the old regime's patrol boat and armed men to go and seize the Phu Quoc islands. And when they were finally expelled by the Vietnamese, Vietnamese found human remains, suggesting people were killed who were found in those islands. And if my memory serves right, it was something like 80 remains were found, but I may be wrong, it's a long time ago. That's all that I can recall at this point.
Merci, Monsieur l'expert. Je n'ai pas d'autres questions pour l'instant.
សូមអរគុណខ្ញុំអត់មានសំណួរទៀតទេ។ខ្ញុំជាបន្តនេះមុននឹងជូនវេទិកាទៅសាប្រញ្ញាដើម្បីមានសំណួរពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងអ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះអង្គជំរះសូមមានបញ្ហាមួយដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងជំនាញចោតទី1គឺអង្គជំរះសូមអាននៅកថាខណ្ឌទី86នៃអង្គហេតុដែលបានព្រមព្រៀងរបស់គូភាគីអំពីចំនួនប្រដាប់អាវុធភ្លាមៗនៅក្រោយថ្ងៃទី17 ខែមេសាឆ្នាំ 75 ចំនួនប្រដាប់អាវុធអន្តរជាតិរវាងកម្ពុជានិងវៀតណាមក៏ផ្ទុះឡើងដែរនិងបានអូសបន្លាយយ៉ាងហោចណាស់រហូតដល់ថ្ងៃទី6 ក៏មិនប្រកាន់យកជំហរអ្វីទេក្រុមវិទ្យាការពីក្តីសូមទុកឲ្យអង្គជំរះជាអ្នកសម្រេចលើចំណុចនេះសំណួរសំសួរទៅជនចាប់ចោតថាតើពាក្យថាមិនបដិសេធអំពីអធិភាពនៃជំនួសរបស់អាវុធនេះដោយមកពីលោកមិនបានដឹងដោយផ្ទាល់អំពីអង្គហេតុនេះឬក៏ដោយសារមូលហេតុលោកចង់រក្សាសិទ្ធិនៅស្ងៀមមិនឆ្លើយតប
ជំរាបសាសន៍លោកប្រធានបញ្ហាការប៉ះទង្គិចគ្នារវាងបកកុម្មុយនីកម្ពុជាហើយនិងបកកុម្មុយនីវៀតណាមខ្ញុំដឹងរហិតលាហៀងតែប៉ុណ្ណោះឯងទេមិនច្បាស់លាស់ទេគ្រាន់តែសូមជំរាបបញ្ជាក់ថាទី 1 ការដែលយើងខ្ញុំដឹងយល់រហូតមកដល់ពេលដែលខែមិនិនាឆ្នាំ 1975 សំទុះ 1976យើងខ្ញុំជឿជាក់ថាលេយុនគេនៅរក្សាផែនការសហព័ន្ធឥណ្ឌូចិនរបស់គេគេនៅតែតាំងខ្លួនថាគេជាបិតាសហព័ន្ធឥណ្ឌូចិនឯចំណែកប៉ុលពតគាត់មិនអនុគ្រោះឲ្យមាន ផែនការសហព័ន្ធឥណ្ឌូចិននៅលើទឹកដីកម្ពុជាទេចំណែកផ្ទាល់ខ្លួនខ្ញុំជាសមាជិកបកកុម្មុយនីកម្ពុជាយើងខ្ញុំជឿទុកចិត្តថាគេតស៊ូការពារប្រទេសជាតិបានគេឆ្លៀសវៃដែរប៉ុលពតប្រហែលមិនគិតតែការងារប្រចាំថ្ងៃចំពោះមុខដូច្នេះរឿងការប៉ះទង្គិចគ្នាប្រដាប់អាវុធដឹងបន្តិចបន្តួចរ៉ែរ៉ាប៉ះដូចខ្ញុំបានរាយការណ៍នៅក្នុងសម័យស៊ើបអង្កេតអញ្ចឹង គឺដឹងតែពីកន្លែងមកកន្លែងត្រង់ម្ដុំតំបន់ហើយតំបន់ផ្លែសន្ទូចតំបន់ផ្លែសន្ទូចនេះគឺវានៅចុងខាងត្បូងខេត្តមណ្ឌលគិរីហើយមកដុំមកកន្លែងទៀតគឺតំណោះគ្នានៅលើលីងប្រេមគេអារឿងកំតំណោះគ្នាខ្ញុំដឹងដល់ប៉ុណ្្នឹងនេះខ្ញុំសូមជម្រាបដោយត្រង់ត្រង់មិនមែនចង់រក្សាសិទ្ធិបដិសេធទេគឺវាមិនដឹង
មិនយកចិត្តទុកដាក់អីទេដោយមានចំណឿជឿជាក់លើប៉ុលពតថាគេអាចដឹកនាំរក្សាអធិបតេយ្យភាពជាតិបានបូរណភាពទឹកដីបានសូមបញ្ចប់ប៉ុណ្ណេះលោកលោកជាត្រីក្រមមានទំនួលអីពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងជួនចាប់ចោលទេអំពីប្រធានទៀតទេលើសម្រួលរបស់ខ្ញុំនេះបាទជាបន្តទៅទៀតសូម ជូនវេទិកានេះទៅសហប្រញ្ញាដើម្បីធ្វើការសួរដេញដោលទៅដល់អ្នកជំនាញនាយចន្ទដាពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងអង្គហេតុជំនួសប្រវត្តិបើមានសូមអញ្ជើញតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាបាទអរគុណលោកប្រធានសួស្តីលោក ចន្ទដាខ្ញុំឈ្មោះសេងប៊ុនខៀងតំណាងឲ្យសហប្រញ្ញាជាតិហើយខ្ញុំមានសំណួរមួយចំនួនដូចតទៅតើលោកបានដឹងអំពីចំនួនខ្មែរក្រហមជាមួយនឹងទាហានលន់នល់ដែរឬទេហើយចំនួននេះកើតឡើងតាំងពីពេលណាមក
If I understood, he said, Khmer dispute with Lon Nol soldiers. I thought the Khmer Rouge were fighting Lon Nol, so there cannot be any dispute.
There is a conflict between the Khmer Rouge and Lon Nol.
Uh,
ta lúc nó chăm tít tha ở nơi không ông ai sự phơi được bao lâu để nhóm mình miền ai cái xa chỉ bị xa ông lấy tế miền tây bị xa không ai trong tầm po pi rồi ba sự phẩm phơi ban sơ sơ tha nơi không ông năm một quan bổn bốn rồi chặt con cũng lang mà chớm được bao phun phì cầm đa ban cho tôi chấp thì hiện nó phun phì bột pì hay đại khánh nó miên cài phốt chỉ nét đặc nom từ thôi ca chấp thì hiện chẳng nô ta lộ nó chạm tế.
Yes, I do.
Lục chân ta ba kim nơi chọn chạm
ta lục đăng tế thà nó pê nó miên ca tu học vốn cả làng này tế.
There has been armed conflict with Vietnam
throughout Vietnam,
the 1977.
Nhóm trong mình chạy thả ta miền chùm lua và đạp ở vốt rồi viên con cầm lăng đã đặt nòm đòi cài bốt chỉ môi nâng cầm lăng rồi bỏ thể hiện phùm phiệp bộ pia đã đặt nòm đòi sọp hâm ta miền đà rời tế.
My information on those episodes actually come from Cambodia experts who studied different Khmer documents. And from what I recall, there was combat, but Sao Phim himself committed suicide when he realized that the central forces were approaching his warehouse and taking shelter.
Nhóm khơi nó không nông sự phơi bỏ lột đai để bản chạy thà nó phê đai cầm lăng rồi bỏ cài phốt cho tập bọt mình tì bạc phùm phía bộ bìa hay phê nút sọp hâm ban bình chia cầm lăng rồi bỏ cốt ôi bỏ dút chi mùi nâng cầm lăng rồi bỏ cài phốt ta nè chia ca phật đà được tế.
Again, as I have no first-hand
knowledge, this is learned from
analysis done by Cambodian scholars based on their reading of Khmer's documents. So I can only say that I believe those scholars maintain that there was
fight.
Chúng rất bắt lúc chắc rõm thà nếu phía đại khmai cơ hôm làng ca nằm nạch liềm phía nút khmai cơ hôm bàn thua ca tiêm tiết cóc môi chùm nuôn đại khuôn bàn tiêm tiết bì môn màu hay chỉ biết xét cứ nâu lơ cóc trol hay nâng cóc rồi chọc xe trong đăng thà phía đại khmai cơ hôm cực rộng hơi nữa miên bẩn đá phía đại khmai cơ hôm chô vì bà hà nó tâm bằng đá ai mà nó rồi có trọng sẵn bắt khối khá đối với khá đại tế.
Lúc chân đà.
Again, my
memory
is not very sharp on that, but I recall that there was considerable damage to property and also killing of people during that time.
ចុះក្រោយពីការប្រយុទ្ធវាប្រហារទៅលើកោះនេះហើយតើមេដឹកនាំថ្នាក់ដឹកនាំវៀតណាមហើយនិងថ្នាក់ដឹកនាំកម្ពុជានឹងមានការចរចាគ្នាលើអ្វីដែរទេ?
I think there was negotiation and as a result of those negotiations, the Vietnamese returned Go Away Island, which they captured in their push to expel the Khmer Rouge from those islands. They had captured Polo Wei, which was a Cambodian island, which they returned later on as a result of the negotiation.
Lúc đăng tế hát ấy bán chia Việt Nam đỏ chánh vì có bộ lộ vai nâng.
Lúc chân đà.
Because I think it has been under Cambodian control all along.
I don't think it was ever
in dispute.
But ownership of that island.
So Vietnamese basically respected the sovereignty of Cambodia or Khmer before, and then this, they returned this as a result of their policy.
តើបន្ទាប់ពីការវាយប្រហាររបស់វៀតណាមទៅលើកោះពូឡាវ៉ៃតើប្រទេសកម្ពុជាមានប្រតិកម្មសងសឹកអ្វីដែរទេទៅលើជនជាតិវៀតណាម
I'm not sure I understand the question whether
Vietnamese revenge on whom?
I have no way of knowing what the Khmerus did vis-à-vis the Vietnamese residents of Cambodia, whether it was done as a matter of established policy not to have ethnic Vietnamese in Cambodia, or whether it was done in revenge.
But
my guess would be that Vietnamese were expelled even before Poloway was captured by the Vietnamese. So I doubt that there is any direct relationship between
these
two.
So I doubt that there
is any direct relationship between these two.
I think both countries did recognize the Brevia Line, but the Brevia Line was not a line to demarcate sovereignty. It was a line where it was clearly stated that the line established police jurisdiction over the islands. I think in 1939 there was no law of the sea to determine what would be the territorial waters or economic zone. All those concepts are more recent, and so the Brevia Line is in some ways inadequate to resolve the dispute that came in that time.
លោកបាននិយាយតែពីចំនួនទៅលើកោះត្រល់ដែលហៅវៀតណាមហៅថាកោះហ្វូកុកហើយកោះកញ្ចក់សេះវៀតណាមហៅថាកោះធូជូហើយនឹងកោះពូឡាវ៉ៃតើមានកោះផ្សេងទៀតដែរទេដែលមានចំនួនហ្នឹង
I think Cambodia has claimed Phukok Island before, and in the Kingdom of Cambodia under Prince Sihanouk, there was an attempt to recover Phukok or Koh Trao Island from South Vietnam,
and
that effort didn't succeed.
But
កន្លងមកឃើញថាមានការពិភាក្សាគ្នារវាងប្រទេសវៀតណាមហើយនិងប្រទេសកម្ពុជាតកតងនឹងសិទ្ធិសញ្ញាមិត្តភាពនិងការមិនឈ្លានពានគ្នាតើលោកបានដឹងបញ្ហានេះដែរទេ
លោកចន្ទា
friendship treaty between
Vietnam, Cambodia, and Vietnam.
ជាមួយនឹងរដ្ឋាភិបាលកម្ពុជានៅពេលនោះហើយមិនចឹងឲ្យមានកិច្ចអឺ and so didn't like the Vietnamese position. ឥឡូវខ្ញុំត្រឡប់មកការអំពាវនាវមួយរបស់វិទ្យុក្រុងភ្នំពេញនៅដែលបានអំពាវនាវនៅថ្ងៃទី10ខែឧសភាឆ្នាំ 1978បានអំពាវនាវឲ្យសម្លាប់ពូជសាសន៍វៀតណាមតើលោកនៅចាំបានទេការអំពាវនាវនេះ
ជនជាតិវៀតណាមអាប្សឺតបាទគឺជាការមួយគួរឲ្យចម្លែកណាស់ដែរគឺនេះបង្ហាញអំពីគោលគំនិតរបស់ខ្មែរក្រហមនៅពេលនោះបាទអរគុណហើយមួយទៀតចង់សួរថាតើលោកនៅចាំឈ្មោះរស់សរឿនដែលបានប្រាប់លោកអំពីលិខិតមួយដែលមានឈ្មោះថាមតិណែនាំរបស់គណៈ808ចុះថ្ងៃទី1ខែមេសាឆ្នាំ1977
តើលោកនៅចាំទេលិខិតនោះឲ្យឈ្មោះរស់សរឿននឹង
Yes, I think the letter was from 870.
ហើយបានស្នើឲ្យគណៈកម្មការសម្លាប់ជនជាតិវៀតណាមទាំងអស់និងនរណាផ្សេងទៀតដែលមានភាពស្និទ្ធស្នាលនឹងវៀតណាមជាសំខាន់ទៅថាជាអូបវៀតណាមីសពីពលបញ្ជីឲ្យសម្លាប់ឬក៏បោះសម្អាតជនជាតិវៀតណាមទាំងអស់ហើយលិខិតនោះគឺឲ្យបោះសម្អាតជនជាតិវៀតណាមតើមានបញ្ជាក់ថាចាប់ជនជាតិវៀតណាមទៅកន្លែងណាទេ
ទៅមណ្ឌលសន្តិសុខឬក៏ទៅកន្លែងណាផ្សេងទៀតដែរឬទេលោកចិនតាអាយឌូណតណូធឌីតែលអាយឌីបានលីដធីលអាយឌីបានបញ្ជាឲ្យសម្លាប់ឬក៏បោះសម្អាតជនជាតិវៀតណាមតើមានបញ្ជាក់ថាចាប់ជនជាតិវៀតណាមទៅកន្លែងណាទេទៅមណ្ឌលសន្តិសុខឬក៏ទៅកន្លែងណាផ្សេងទៀតដែរឬទេលោកចិនតាអាយឌូណតណូធឌីតែលអាយឌីបានលីដធីលអាយឌីបានបញ្ជាឲ្យសម្លាប់ឬក៏បោះសម្អាតជនជាតិវៀតណាមតើមានបញ្ជាក់ថាចាប់ជនជាតិវៀតណាមនេះ Yeah, I do not recall exactly what I wrote at the time, but I am sure if I had written that, it was based on information that I got from reliable sources.
ពីប្រភពដែលខ្ញុំទទួលបាននៅពេលនោះលោកបានឆ្លើយប្រាប់លោកស្រីចាប់ក្រុមមុននឹង
I think the attack took place all along southwest, in Vietnam's southwest border,
and
Svai Rieng was the area, I recall, where the Vietnamese forces had gone in and stayed put
for a period.
នៅ ពេល ដែល កង កម្លាំង វៀតណាម ចូល វាយ ប្រហារ ដូច្នេះ តើ កម្លាំង របស់ ខ្មែរ ក្រហម មាន ប្រតិកម្ម តប វិញ យ៉ាង ម៉េច ដែរ
I think there are occasions when there was very stiff resistance fight, and there are other occasions when there was very little resistance, so it was not uniform everywhere.
ដោយលក្ខណៈត្រង់ទ្រីស្រាគឺมันមានការលាក់ពាក់ត្រឹមត្រូវជាលក្ខណៈយោធាតើពេលនោះបណ្ដាលឲ្យមានមនុស្សស្លាប់ឬក៏ខូចខាតសម្បត្តិអ្វីទេលោកបានចាំទេ
I think there was considerable damage to property, but also I recall that in many occasions, especially since end of 77, early 78, when Vietnamese troops entered Cambodia, they often came back with many Cambodians who wanted to escape with the Vietnamese troops. The Vietnamese army trucks brought back many Cambodians who wanted to live in the safety of Vietnam.
And
I have visited some camps where I met such Khmers who have been living in Vietnam after being evacuated by the Vietnamese soldiers.
នៅ ពេល ដែល មាន ចំនួន គ្នា នោះ តើ ទាហាន វៀតណាម មាន ចាប់ បាន ទាហាន ខ្មែរ ក្រហម ដែរ ឬ ទេ
Yes, I think they did capture quite a few Khmer Rouge soldiers.
ទាហាន វៀតណាម
បាន ចាប់ They were brought back.
ទាហាន ខ្មែរ ក្រហម មួយ ចំនួន
ហើយ Again, I was told that they were
ទាហាន វៀតណាម បាន
នាំ
យក ទៅ ប្រទេស គេ
ហើយ ខ្ញុំ បាន not really any committed Khmer Rouge. And so they were being given re-education as told that they were being given some political lectures and perhaps to turn them into fighters for liberation of Cambodia later on. That was the purpose.
Hay cho lúc đăng tới thà nấu phê và dốt khí nâng ta thể hiện khả mai của hôm miên chấp ban thể hiện Việt Nam vinh đại thế.
Yes, I think so. This is what I said, that the Khmer Rouge soldiers were captured and brought back to Vietnam in some of the camps the Vietnamese had set up to receive the Khmer population coming to Vietnam, as well as a specific area where those captured Khmer Rouge soldiers were kept to be re-educated.
ខ្ញុំចង់សួរថាទាហានខ្មែរក្រហមមានចាប់បានទាហានវៀតណាមដែរឬទេនៅពេលដែលប្រយុទ្ធគ្នាម្ដងៗហ្នឹង
I'm not aware of
ខ្ញុំអត់បានដឹងចំពោះ
Vietnamese being arrested, it is possible, but I do not have any detail on that.
ក្នុងការប្រយុទ្ធគ្នាមួយទៀតនៅក្នុងឆ្នាំ 1971ដោយកងទ័ពកងពលធំលេខ9ដែលគាំទ្រដោយកងកម្លាំងធំជាច្រើនរបស់វៀតណាមហ្នឹងបានធ្វើការលុកលុយដល់ធំមួយទៅលើកម្ពុជាបណ្ដាលឲ្យទាហានកម្ពុជាហ្នឹងមានរបួសជាច្រើនហើយទាហានខ្មែរក្រហមដែលមានរបួសហ្នឹងគេបញ្ជូនទៅមន្ទីរពេទ្យនៅទីក្រុងភ្នំពេញហើយ ចាំត្រូវការចាំបាច់នៅការរៃអង្គាសឈាមដើម្បីបញ្ចូលទៅឲ្យទាហានដែលត្រូវរបួសហ្នឹងតើលោកដឹងទេថាការរៃអង្គាសឈាមហ្នឹងគេប្រមូលបានពីណាមក
No, I'm afraid I have no idea about what you mentioned about wounded being brought to Phnom Penh
or
being given blood transfusion. I was unaware of that.
ព្រោះថានៅក្នុងឯកសាររបស់លោកក៏បានបញ្ជាក់ដែរថាមានការរៃអង្គាសឈាមពីសប្បុរសជនឬក៏ពីអង្គភាពផ្សេងៗដើម្បីឲ្យជួយទៅដល់ទាហានវៀតណាមដែលមានរបួសតើលោកបានចាំទេ
Can you give me the page reference where I don't recall that.
ខ្ញុំមានតែលេខទំព័រជាភាសាខ្មែរមិនដឹងថាលេខទំព័រជាភាសាអង់គ្លេសលេខប្រមាណលេខទំព័រជាភាសាខ្មែរគឺលេខ 234 ភាសាលេខទំព័រភាសាអង់គ្លេសគឺលេខ 206 ហើយ EON លេខ 00192391
Yes, I see that. That was actually that information was taken from a book written by Laurence Peak. Au delà du ciel, cinq ans chez les Khmer Rouges. It's an account by a French woman who lived in Cambodia. She was married to a Khmer Rouge cadre. And she wrote that in her book, so I have taken that information from her book.
យុទ្ធសាស្ត្រដែលមានឈ្មោះថាការវាយប្រហារផ្លេកបន្ទោជ័យជំនះផ្លេកបន្ទោតើលោកធ្លាប់ឮយុទ្ធសាស្ត្រនេះទេ
Yes, I have heard that.
ខ្ញុំបាន
ស្លូកាន
ឮអំពីពាក្យស្លោកដូចនោះ
Ta lúc đăng tới thà vô được xa ní kì thơ đậm bay ở vấy hay nẹ ná chỉ nẹ ăn vọt vô được xa ní
I do not recall the exact context of those, that slogan, but clearly the Khmer Rouge attacks that happened along Vietnamese border, they were lightning attacks, surprise attacks, and they did succeed in killing a lot of people, killing civilians, a mark of success, it was a very successful lightning attack. Conflict between Cambodia and Vietnam, the period we are considering from 75 to 79,
it has
been taking place off and on and with increasing frequency since 76 and rising in crescendo until the final Vietnamese attack in December 78. So the attacks have been initially by the Khmer Rouge,
and
Vietnamese counter-attacks began in 77,
but
until December 77, these conflicts remained hidden from public eye. Because both sides did not publicize them.
Miền ca lược lang thà ca prayut khnir ruvieng Campuchia hay nang Vietnam nung cứ miền sơn tu can lang chi lủng đập ta lục vô dạng nào đấy trầm trơ đại rồi thế.
Yes, I do believe that they intensified.
Certainly
from 1977, middle of
77.
Ta lok ban dung ampi yodasa robo Vietnam da nom o Vietnam nung ban samrat chok chay dang srong to le kong top khmai ka hom ta Việt Nam miền du lịch dạng nào đấy hay hạt ấy ban chia khmai có hôm tranh sừng kềm dạng đội chân này là lục ai ăn thịt bài ban đại tế.
The Vietnamese strategy looking back at how the operation went off was designed to use maximum force, armored personal carrier, tank, artillery, and air support to destroy the Khmer Rouge defenses and capture Phnom Penh, and then from Phnom Penh fan out to the provinces and to the islands. Koh Kong was the last place where it was captured, and that was
Vietnam
at the time it was called the Blooming Lotus Strategy, but that may not have been what the Vietnamese called it, because that was the strategy that was applied by Vietnam in 1975.
Ban mấy lô ban ខ្ញុំឃើញនៅក្នុងសភើរបស់លោកដែរដែលបញ្ជាក់ថានិយាយអំពីកប៉ាល់ម៉ាយ៉ាហ្គេរបស់សហរដ្ឋអាមេរិកដែលកងទ័ពខ្មែរក្រហមវាដណ្ដើមយកតើនៅពេលដែលកងទ័ពខ្មែរក្រហមកាន់កាប់បានកប៉ាល់ម៉ាយ៉ាហ្គេនេះហើយណាតើអាមេរិកមានការយល់ឃើញយ៉ាងម៉េចឬក៏ឆ្លើយតបយ៉ាងម៉េចដែរចំពោះការរឹបអូកប៉ាល់របស់អាមេរិកនេះ
I think the United States sent in jet fighters and
ban
they actually used a lot of bombing
ban
and
prayot, prachang,
showed the Khmer Rouge that that was a mistake. So I think
I described
that episode in my book, and it was based on the accounts I have read because I was not there. Did I witness the attack or American counterattack?
But
there's a book on the seizure of Mayaguez and that was my principal source for that section.
តើលោកដឹងទេថាអាមេរិកមានទីតាំងកន្លែងណាដើម្បីឈរជើងវាយជាមួយខ្មែរក្រហមហ្នឹង
No, I do not recall, but I know that the Thai U.S. had bases in Thailand, and that could have been easily usable, but I am not sure as to whether that was the case.
I don't
know if you have any questions. I don't know if you have any questions. I don't know if you have any questions. I don't know if you have any questions. I don't know if you have any questions. I don't know if you have
Yes, indeed. There were clashes along the Thai-Cambodia border.
And
there was also an acquisition by the Khmer Rouge about Thai airplane bomb bombing inside Cambodia.
But
I have no confirmation that that was indeed the case of Thai bombing. But there were different clashes along Thai-Cambodia border in the northwest.
Ta lok ban dang te tha chumluo no tam prom dan rovieng Cambodia chmuoy nang Thai nang ta kat lang nyak nyoy ruk dai ru te.
No, I do not think it was more frequent than Vietnam.
And in fact, since 1978,
since the visit of
Vice
Premier Deng Xiaoping from China to Thailand and Southeast Asia,
there was a
definite cooling down of tension between Thailand and Korea.
Because
the focus was on Vietnam and
Cambodia. But the focus was on Cambodia and Vietnam.
The focus was on Cambodia and Vietnam. The focus was on Cambodia and Vietnam.
Vietnam-Cambodia conflict until December 31st, 1977 was not known in any detail. There were unconfirmed reports and speculation in the press based on hints offered by these governments,
but
full knowledge extent of the conflict or casualties came to be known only when the Khmer Rouge declared that they are suspending relations with Vietnam.
តាមលោកបានលើកមុននឹងលោកថាលោកបានធ្លាប់ជួបជាមួយមេដឹកនាំជាច្រើនជាពិសេសមេដឹកនាំរបស់កម្ពុជាមេដឹកនាំរបស់វៀតណាមតើមេដឹកនាំទាំងនោះបានពិភាក្សាអំពីចំនួនរវាងកម្ពុជាហើយនិងវៀតណាមដែរឬទេ
Yes, Mr. Yangsari,
in 1979,
I had an interview with him, and he basically said what has been now said many times about Vietnamese are being aggressive.
Vietnam
country and Cambodia is trying to defend itself from Vietnam. So I think in conversations with Yangsari there was no question that there was a conflict going on. I had interviewed Prime Minister Pham Van Dong in December 1977. At that stage, the conflict between Vietnam and Cambodia still was not public because that was in mid-December my interview with Prime Minister Pham Van Dong and the announcement from Phnom Penh came a few days later. But I asked Prime Minister Pham Van Dong about conflict to Cambodia and he was very cautious. He admitted there was some problem and it could be resolved. But he was not willing to give any detail about the kind of conflict that had occurred.
Tam da lok thlop chup chmuoy me dak nom tang tang pi nang ta លោក អាច វា តម្លៃ បាន ទេ ថា គោល បំណង របស់ មេ ដឹក នាំ ទាំង 2 ហ្នឹង មាន ចិត្ត ចង់ ដោះ ស្រាយ ពី ចំនួន បញ្ហា រវាង ប្រទេស និង ប្រទេស ហ្នឹង ដែរ ទេ
លោក ចន្ទា
I think the interviews are more for getting a little bit of nuance or some nugget of information but I don't think whether someone is genuinely interested to have a negotiated settlement. I don't think it can be revealed in interview with the journalist.
What I do know is that the
depth of feeling on the part of the Khmer Rouge was such that it was extremely difficult. Basically, they had no trust in the Vietnamese. And the Vietnamese were hopeful that some elements in the Khmer Rouge movement would be more reasonable. Those who had had previous cooperation with the Vietnamese party, they were more understanding of the necessity of working together. And so I suspect, nobody has said this to me, but I suspect the Vietnamese were being cautious in responding to the Khmer Rouge provocations in the hope that some elements, moderate or reasonable elements within the Khmer Rouge movement would eventually march and make it unnecessary for the Vietnamese to go into an open conflict with Cambodia. So that, I think, was their expectation and hope.
គឺតាមមានការបង្ហាញអំពីសេចក្តីសង្ឃឹមរបស់គាត់ប៉ុន្តែទីបំផុតគឺថាมันបានកើតឡើងទេបាទសូមអរគុណឥឡូវខ្ញុំអស់សំណួរហើយសូមអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យសហការីអន្តរជាតិរបស់ខ្ញុំបន្តសំណួរបើសិនជាមានបាទសូមអញ្ជើញតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាអន្តរជាតិ
Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon, Mr. Chanda. My name is Alex Bates. Together with Mr. Seng Boon King, I represent the co-prosecutors, and I have a few questions for you. You've informed us that your memory is perhaps unsurprisingly a little hazy of the events that took place 30 or more years ago. Can I ask you to say whether when you wrote the book, Brother Enemy, your memory was a little clearer than it is now?
Perhaps an obvious question, but can I start there?
Yes, surely.
បាទប៉ុន្តែពេលនោះការចងចាំរបស់ខ្ញុំនៅភាសាជាងខ្ញុំបានសរសេរសៀវភៅហ្នឹងគឺនៅក្នុងឆ្នាំ83អល់ដូ
You wrote the book in 1985, and you've described in fairly thorough detail in your footnotes the sources that you used to write the book. In general terms, do you consider the sources that you quoted to be reliable?
Mostly reliable, and sometimes I quote a source not necessarily because it is reliable, but because it has a documentary value. For instance, the May 10th broadcast of the Khmer
Rouge,
broadcast was made itself is very important to note whether the sentiments or information given there are clear enough to send the point.
Yes, thank you. Perhaps a follow-up question. Did you knowingly cite any sources that you did not believe to be accurate, other than those occasions that you just mentioned for other reasons?
No, I will not do that. Look, Chanda, take him and man for the next
day. I'd just like to ask a little about your own research methods at the time you were a journalist and an editor. In the 1970s and 1980s, as a rule, did you keep written notes of the interviews you conducted? Were there cassette tapes or film versions of your interviews? Perhaps you could just describe your methodology for us, please.
The official
interviews, I would tape.
បាទខ្ញុំនឹងថតជាខ្សែអាត់នឹងធ្វើជាប្រតិចារៈ
And just to confirm, the notes that you made from which you compiled your book, would it be fair to say that those notes of the incident were at a time when the incidents were still fresh in your memory?
Yes, indeed.
These notes were taken at the time immediately after I was witnessing
this.
Yes, indeed.
You've told us on a number of occasions that you had access to some rather influential people at the time. Perhaps if you could please explain for us how it came about that you had such privileged access to such important people.
I think, you know, it's very difficult to know why people will talk to me. I can guess several factors that are at play. First of all, I was Indochina correspondent of the Far Eastern economy in the UN, which was considered to be the Bible for the region, and most influential paper. And being their reporter gave me a very special position vis-à-vis everybody who wanted get their views or ideas
out.
Secondly, I think, for me it was not just reporting a story and moving on to something different. I have been interested in China as a scholar before I became a journalist. I had worked in Sorbonne for 3 years on a thesis which I didn't finish in Cambodia,
and so my
background,
knowledge
about country, the problems, perhaps gave me a little bit of an edge over others in understanding issues and asking the right questions. And so I found people were interested in talking to me because they thought that I understood issues and asked questions which are relevant. So that would be my guess.
You've given examples of the types of people to whom you had access. I wonder if you can perhaps expand on that just a little. For example, you refer in various instances in footnotes in your book, conversations you had with editors of regional newspapers. Perhaps starting there and moving on to any other influential sources that you can recall. Could you help us, please?
Sure. I think of the newspaper editors who proved invaluable
sources.
Mr. Huang Tung, he was the editor of Vietnamese Party Daily, and he was a Central Committee member. So as a result, he was privy to a lot of information that ordinary reporters wouldn't know. And because he had this role as an editor, he was more approachable for journalists. So I have seen him many times, and he had a great sense of humor, and he enjoyed conversation, and in the process gave information which turned out to be correct, and so I was privileged to have that kind of sources. As to government officials, I had access to government officials in all the capitals from Beijing to Hanoi to Bangkok. Phnom Penh was the only place I could not come during these 4 years. I had seen
Khmer
Rouge outside the country. And also, I have to correct one thing I said earlier. I did see Mr. Yansari after he was out of power. I saw him in 1979 in Colombo, after he had been removed from power in Colombo. And I saw him later on in 1980s as well. But these government officials again were interested in finding out what I knew
and
give me something more. So it was always a conversation which perhaps had both sides.
This might be a little difficult for you to answer in specific terms, but trying to build up
in terms of people who are officials or people who have some way of knowing information more than average person, I would say several dozens, maybe 100, I don't know. It's
very hard to say. Yes.
Can you please move on To specific sources in your book, the propositions that have been quoted at pages 32 to 33 of your book, which bears an ERN of in English 00019221820019221219. And that source
you refer in footnotes as being
Yang Seri's interview with Patrice de Beer, P-A-T-R-I-C-E-D-E-B-E-E-R, who was the Southeast Asia correspondent of the French newspaper Le Monde. And the interview took place between Monsieur de Beer in October 1975. In particular, at pages 32 to 33, you discuss from that interview Yang Seri's explanation regarding the pre-1954 French colonial maps. And this, I think, relates to the question of the maritime borders and the Plevelian line. First of all, can you just confirm the source for us, that indeed was a source that you used to support your conclusions regarding the attitude of both parties to the border in question?
Yes, sir. Patrice de Beer, a very dear friend, and I do not recall whether and this was precisely the words he published in Le Monde, but he shared his notes with me, and I quote from those notes.
Thank you. We haven't yet had it explained to us in full what exactly the Plevelian line was. You referred to it briefly in answer to questions from my colleague. Perhaps I should spell it for the transcript. It's B-R-E-V-I-E acute. Perhaps if you could take a few moments to explain to us what the Plevelian line was and why it was controversial for the Cambodians at that time.
Again, I have to forgiveness in my somewhat vagueness of my question answering, because this is again a very complex issue.
My memory is that in 1939, this line was drawn from
the land border marking Vietnam and Cambodia, extended in the sea in that angle of the border, and it was decided that north of that line, all the islands would fall under Cambodian police jurisdiction, and south would fall under Vietnamese. And since the line sort of cut across Phu Quoc Island, an exception was made by dotted line surrounding Phu Quoc, so that Phu Quoc stays on the Vietnamese side
for police jurisdiction.
And when this issue came up between Vietnam and Cambodia in 1975, that line had acquired a different significance, because there was search for oil and gas in the Gulf of Thailand. And so the question of sovereignty of the islands would affect what would be the territorial waters and why one can have exploration for gas and oil. And that is why the issue of who controls the north of the Brevier line or south of the Brevier line, and whether that actually demarcated sovereignty became an important issue. I had interviewed the Vietnamese Prime Minister, Mr. Phan Hien, and I asked him about whether Vietnam accepted Brevier line. And he indicated that Vietnam did, but then in a caveat he said, when Vietnam agreed to Brevier line, there was no such question of undersea resources, gas and oil. So I got the impression that the issue of Brevier line was not closed, it was subject to further negotiations.
And in fact, just to complete, what Yang Sari was mentioning to your colleague Mr. De Beer was that there was a problem also with the pre-1954 maps. For what reason? I can remind you of the page again, it's pages 32 and 33. If you could just perhaps elaborate on that a little.
Yeah, this has been one of the Cambodian complaints about the border demarcation. Because South Vietnam, then Cochin China, was a French colony, so while drawing the border demarcation, the Cambodians complained that the Vietnamese side or the French colonial side was favored. So, and that is what Yang Sari is referring to. Because Cochin China was a direct French colony, the border line was drawn, which was favoring the Vietnamese side rather than the Cambodian side.
Vietnam and Cambodia. Do you know the language in which Mr. De Beer spoke to Mr. Yang Sari?
In French.
Perhaps I should have asked you this at the beginning. Which of the regional languages do you personally speak, Mr. Chanda?
I speak, my mother tongue is Bengali, I speak Hindi,
Bengali,
and
Hindi,
French.
And the interviews conducted with the regional leaders
were
able to assist us with whether you used generally a translator verbal whether the leader spoke in a mutually intelligible language.
With Yang Seri, I spoke in French. Mr. Pham Man Dong, it was through an interpreter. The Prime Minister doesn't speak to foreign reporters in any other language. But with other Vietnamese officials, I spoke French or English.
Moving on to another source for a different point. The point that you've discussed already relates to one point you have discussed already, relates to the motivations for conflict on both sides. And at pages 31 to 32 of your book, which appear at 00192217 to 00192218 in English, you refer in the footnotes to a source from Norodom Sihanouk and the memoir La Calice
jusqu'à la Lie.
And in the section in your book to which I've referred, Norodom Sihanouk recounts a story of his own trip to Hanoi with
Khieu Somphan
and the refusal of Khieu Somphan to dine together with Lao and Vietnamese communists. Could you perhaps explain a little what that passage of your book relates to?
This passage relates to the Cambodian sensitivity, the Khmer Rouge sensitivity to the notion of special relationship. This has been actually the most important issue between the Khmer Rouge and the Vietnamese party. Vietnamese-dominated Indochinese Communist Party was formed to fight for liberation of French Indochina, including Cambodia and Laos, and the Indochinese Communist Party had members from Laos and Cambodia, though very few, but they were members.
And when
Indochinese Communist Party was disbanded in order to have national party set up, in 1951, Khmer People's Revolutionary Party, KPRP, was founded in 1951, and Lao People's Party was founded at the same time. But this was just for the show. The Vietnamese maintained a good relations, close relationship with these two parties, and believed that these three parties should work together, because not only Indochina was one political unit under the French, but geographically, strategically, it made sense for them to work together in order to protect their sovereignty and their social system. And the Khmer Rouge that was the big departure from the previous Cambodian party policy. When Pol Pot took over the party, first as deputy secretary in 1960, and then in 1963 as secretary of the party, and that was when also he decided that the birthday of the party should be changed to 1960 rather than 1951. And that action was again the purpose of severing connection with the Vietnamese, that Cambodian party was something original, founded by the Khmer, and nothing to do with the Vietnamese. So this long explanation is to say that when Khieu Somphan refuses to attend the dinner involving Vietnamese and Lao, he is refusing to take part in anything that could be seen as Indochina Federation.
Mr. President, I wonder whether that is a convenient time to break.
ដែលគួរតែដល់ពេលក្នុងការយើងជប់សម្រាប់ហើយលោកប្រធានខ្ញុំយល់ដូច្នោះគុណលោកសញ្ញាឥឡូវនឹងយើងអង្គរិយប្រកាសសម្រាប់20នាទីរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 3 និង 15 នាទីសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តសកម្មភាពយើងទៀតហើយមន្ត្រីតុលាការសម្រាប់រួលដើម្បីអ្នកជំនាញបានទទួលនៅកន្លែងសម្រាប់ជប់សម្រាប់នេះបានសមរម្យ